pull itself away. Just the natural contraction of the muscle. Now, I make the statement on here that if you're not sure if it's, you know, to touch, before you even touch it, you know, do with your own brain intelligently investigate, could this thing be energized? Because if it's energized, I don't even want to touch it with the back of my hand. Okay? But in general, you'll walk up to a piece of equipment that should be safe, and these are safe, and just brush it with the back of your right hand, keeping your other hand as far away as you can. Now, when we work on this equipment, learn the habit that touch it with one hand, keep the other hand away. I had some students would work the breaker, and they would put one hand up here, they'd lean over, and then they'd grab the breaker with the other hand and trip the breaker on. And I'd tell them, look at what you're doing. You're putting both hands against a bonded system here. It's electrified. It's bonded. It'll carry current. And your power supply, you know. And what we tell you to do is we teach you to stand with your back facing the board. So one hand's free, not touching anything. The other hand touching the breaker. And you turn the breaker on. And then when you turn it off, you're going to do it the same way. Now, why should you not face the breaker? If the breaker is closing into a fault, and the breaker fails to clear the fault, the breaker can actually explode. And when these types of breakers explode, they're made of black plastic material that turns into shrapnel that's going to fly everywhere. I'd much rather you injure one hand than injure your whole torso or have your eyes, your face facing it and injure your face and possibly damage your vision, okay? So face away from it. Also, you wanna be stepping aside so that instead of standing here where you're gonna get your rear end injured, stand over here. Now, we have never had any kind of a catastrophic failure of any equipment. We've had some breakers fail, but they failed safe, which is the way we've designed systems, and we replaced them with new breakers. So that happens, okay? So, there's just some protocols that you should just teach yourself and learn how to do. Now, safe clothing. In general, I'm just looking real quick, except for the fleece over here, Mr. Electrician. Everybody is generally okay, but basically our cotton polyester type blend fabrics that we have are okay in this particular lab. If you work as an electrician out in the field, this wouldn't be okay. You actually would tell you and probably provide for you proper clothing that resist burning and sustaining a flame when they get hot. Okay? Generally, everything you guys have on is okay. If I see someone coming in with, you know, pink polyester, fully polyester, I might say, gee, that's not a good shirt to have. Why don't you be safety officer today? So just be thinking about now the fuzzy fleece and things like that. The reason that they're dangerous is the surface of them, there's a lot of fabric that sticks out into the air, so there's a lot of oxygen around the fabric itself. If it ignites, there's a lot of oxygen there and it will sustain a flame and it'll keep burning. So you want to make sure that we're dressed in ways that won't necessarily sustain a flame. Get an electrician, there's actually fabrics that are made that are specifically shirts, and they look just like normal shirts, button-down collars, but they're just made out of a fabric. They're much more expensive, but you don't need to have that for this lab. Just know that that type of product is out there. So, the other thing is loose clothing. If you have, you know, your your collars, your cuffs are unbuttoned or something like that, and you have something that's hanging down that can be caught up in the rotating equipment, again, I'll have you take that off, secure it, do something so that you're safe around this rotating equipment. So, basically we want to do this during the lab. No illusion of baggy clothing, and that's just because we're around rotating equipment, okay? We, your shirt sleeves, either buttoned, a lot of you, like Wu here, has his shirt sleeves rolled up. That's okay too, just as long as it's not down and hanging around in some way, okay? The shirts, cotton wool, polyester blends, everything that I'm seeing in general that we have on here are okay. Now, wristbands and watches and rings and things like that, I don't have you take them off. Like in my situation, watch band that's real close to my wrist, my wedding band, it's on there really tight and it's not going to fall off. If I were an electrician in the field, might have me take my wedding band off. I'm working with positively energized equipment, but see here, I'm okay. Okay. Open-toed shoes and sandals. We've already talked about that. That no, we don't want that. Shoes need to have rubber soles. If you have leather-soled shoes and your foot is sweating, what is the conductivity basically of that leather underneath your foot? That's right. So, just be thinking, you know, the leather shoe might be a really great, comfortable shoe, but in here, it's actually no protection at all. It's like you're working in here with bare feet, especially if your feet are sweaty, okay? The common tennis shoes are the best thing. I had a female student several semesters ago. She came up to me afterwards, she says, I don't even own a pair of tennis shoes. You know, and I said, you know, $12 at Walmart, you know, just go get something inexpensive that you can just wear in here to assure that you're safe in terms of keeping your feet. Now, long hair, looking at all you male engineers out here, anything that's going to be down and hanging as you're looking over that could get caught up into a piece of a rotating shaft, long hair you need to make sure is tied back and out of the way, okay? So there's a lot of the lab practices that you're going to learn in here that are directly applicable to the real world and industry. The one-hand rule, things like that, you're going to learn how to calibrate instruments and read them, how to clamp on an amp probe, how to measure voltages. There's a lot of things that you're going to be doing in here that will be directly applicable. Now, just a second. Come on. Now, before you come into the lab each week, make sure that you have read the lab. How many of you have bought the lab books? Are they available yet? So, have you bought it yet? How much did it cost?
$10.
$10?
You like this packet?
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
$10. I'll autograph it if you want me to autograph it. This is the first semester that we've done a color version. Yeah. Okay. Read the lab beforehand, just so that you're prepared with what's going on. If you have questions, you can ask beforehand. Generally, semester after semester after semester, I have a hard copy of this lab, and I make notes to myself when you guys come up with questions where the wording, the nomenclature, the wiring diagram, that there's something that you didn't understand about the lab. By and large, you should be able to come in here, and you're all smart people, and you should be able to do this lab without me here. But I am here wanting to make sure that you're learning what we need you to learn in this lab. But they're very self-explanatory, but you should read it beforehand just so that you're prepared as you come in, okay? Look at the textbook and Dr. Ammerman. One of the reasons that we do this historic background last week, safety this week, and an introductory lab next week is I'm letting Dr. Ammerman get out ahead of me. Because we don't want you to be studying transformers if you're just going over it in the lecture. It'd be much better for you to study transformers after you've already studied it in the textbook, you've done some of the calculations of an equivalent circuit of a transformer, what is back EMF, why is it important, why is it beneficial, and how does it work, that type of thing, okay? So, we're letting Dr. Ammerman get out ahead of us. So, but if you're studying the textbook and what's going on in the textbook, what happens in the lab will really make a lot of sense to you. My hope is that your aha experiences occur here in the lab as you're working with it with your hands, rather than in the lecture lab, you go, oh, well, that's why we did that in the lab. Because a lot of the things that will happen in the lab will go right over your head. You want to understand what's the significance of it at all. Why do you do this? So, anyway, study the textbook. Now, you know, just get yourself organized and anticipate in your mind what readings you need to make, what meters you need, what instruments you need. We have a whole lot of instruments over here in the cabinet and on the different lab books or lab benches that you'll need to make sure that you use. You'll want to make sure you check the calibration of the meters, not only of the meter itself, of the amp probe that we're going to be using. There's two adjustments that you have to make. One of them is the input off the amp probe into the meter. The meter has to be set for the proper voltage input off the amp probe. It's 100 milliamps. Then the amp probe itself has a zero adjustment, and you need to make sure that you've adjusted the zero on the amp probe so that its reading is close to zero when you have no current flow as you possibly can. You're never going to get it precisely right. You're going to see that there's an inherent inaccuracy that's always there, and you just have to learn that's life. And it's going to, we'd have to spend $10,000 on these meters and put in a Faraday cage around us, get rid of the fluorescent lights, get rid of all magnetic fields that are in here in order for these instruments to have better accuracy than they do. But they're quite adequate for what we do in this lab. You should also make sure that you've looked at your readings. I'm going to be helping you do this. I'm going to be looking at your data, and I will even present to you data from previous labs that I've done or students have done. You can look at your data. Is my data what I'm expecting? Because what I don't want you to do is go through the whole experiment and find out that you've got something wired wrong, something wrong, and you've wasted 45 minutes. Okay? So you're going to make sure that what you're measuring is accurate before you start putting things away. Now, we're also going to observe safety rules. Now, you guys working on the wires here, stop a second and pay attention, okay? Now, electricity is predictable. That's one of the reasons why we can study and get an engineering degree in electricity. It's going to react in very predictable ways. We know what those ways are, and so we can make sure that we are handling electricity safely. Now, when you start misusing electricity is when you can get in trouble. One of the things, a lot of you are friendly, you enjoy jokes and things. I don't mind humor in the lab. What I do mind is rowdiness, pushing each other, horsing around in some way that you're not paying attention to what you're doing. And somebody can get energized, somebody can get hurt. Now, if we treat the electricity with respect, we're going to be fine. Now, let me know what an AED is. pick. Those of you who don't know what an AED is, it is the automated external defibrillator. It is a machine that is capable of restarting a heart that is in fibrillation. Now, where is the closest AED to this lab?
The office over in DW, down the hall.
Yeah, you know where the Starbucks is? Directly above the Starbucks at this level, there's an AED right at the top of the stairs. As you go elsewhere in the building, look for them. Okay. How many of you have had training on how to use an AED? Okay, keep your hands up. Look in here. These are the people you want to make sure are in this lab and are healthy. Okay? Now, how many of you have had CPR training? Okay, a whole lot more. This is good. Those of you who have had CPR training know the scenario we're talking about, where you've got a person who's down, has no pulse, has no breathing. That's when we kick in and start doing CPR. And we were given this 3 to 7 minute time period. Using CPR, we can extend that period of time. I've talked to emergency services here on campus. They tell me that they can be to this room within 3.5 minutes. I like that. But I want to give them more than 30 to 40 seconds or a minute once they get here to save a life. So we're going to be doing CPR if necessary. So I want to talk a little bit, what are we going to do if an accident happens? Because there's 24 of us in here, 25 with me. There's a big crowd of people. And we can do some things to make sure that we increase the probability of saving the life of someone who has injured themselves and is down. Okay. If you're at a lab station and something happens and suddenly someone plops down on the floor right next to you, what's the first thing that you should do? I hear ask for help.
Check a pulse.
I hear check a pulse, touch them.
Make sure they're not electrified.
Okay. There's a lot of good suggestions, but the first thing you should do is you should take a half a step away from them. Because if they're still energized, you don't want to touch them. You want to take a half a step back and then intelligently look quickly. What just happened? Why are they down? Are they still energized? If you decide to touch them, how do you first touch them? You know, touch them with the back of your hand. If you're not feeling anything, it's now safe to touch them. Those of us who've had CPR training, we're going to be checking for a pulse. We're going to be checking the carotid artery. We're going to be listening to the breath. Are we seeing breath? And if we're not seeing breath, we're then going to start taking some action. Now, I've had training in CPR, first aid training, things like that. I've been fortunate that I've never actually had to physically do it myself. I've done it on dummies and mannequins and things such as that. But what we're going to do is that we need to get some help here as fast as we possibly can. So, if I am in here and alert, and those of you listening on via videotape, we need to get two people at the person that's down that are going to be responsible for doing CPR. If I'm in the lab, I'm going to be one of those two people. I'm going to point to two other people, and I'm going to say, you two, do you have your cell phones? If the answer is no, you two, do you have your cell phones? And I'm going to say, you get emergency people here as soon as possible. And then I'm going to go back to what I'm doing. You two, first thing you're going to do is you're going to send somebody to the main office. And so that you're notifying the main office that we've got an injured student in this lab. You're gonna call 911. One of you will get a connection to 911. The other's gonna be standing by and helping. The one that's standing by, you're gonna find four other students. You, and you. And the four of you are gonna go to the four corners of this building on the sidewalk. And what you're gonna do is when the emergency services get here, you're gonna get them straight to this room as quickly as you can. Because they won't know exactly where BB-302 is. So you're gonna run them in here. We're gonna be doing CPR. Now, the other thing that's gonna happen is one of you two is then gonna point to somebody else. You go get, actually you're gonna talk to two people. Two of you, you go get the AED. And the two of you are going to run to get the AED. You're not gonna stop to talk to anybody. You're not gonna say, oh man, you'll never guess what's happened in the lab. No, you're gonna run, get the AED, and you're gonna run back. That's all you're gonna do, and you're gonna bring the AED down to the people, the two that are working, doing CPR. The rest of you, I want you to clear the tables away from where we're at. And then I want you to back off away. It's okay to stay in the room, but if other people start coming in the room, other students that are not involved, you need to tell them, please leave. Be polite, but firm, please leave. Emergency personnel can come in, head office, admin people, they can come in, but you just need to stay out of the way. Now, those of you who've had AED training, what we have to do to apply an AED to you is we have to take your shirt and open your shirt so we have a bare chest. There are electrodes that we will stick to your skin, we will connect up to the AED, and it will actually induce a charge across your chest to try to spark your heart to get it out of fibrillation and to get it naturally pumping again. If it can do that, wow, that's great. If it can't do that, it's going to try to do it again. Now the AEDs that we have are vocal commands. We turn it on and it will say, you know, prepare pads, you know, place pads on victim or something like that. It'll be talking to us. But I have to let all of you know that we're going to do that. Ladies, we're going to have to do that. And if you have a brassiere on, we're going to have to get the brassiere out of the way so we can get the charges on there. And it's just something we're going to have to do. So, once we're there, the AED will do its charge. It will try to re-energize you. If the AED doesn't work, we're going to still be doing compressions. We're still going to be doing breathing to keep oxygen to your brain. When the emergency personnel get here, they've got injections, they have training, they have all sorts of things. But what's going to happen, they're going to come in the room. Those of us who are doing CPR, we're going to continue doing compressions and breathing until the EMT people relieve us in some way. Okay? I just want you to know, that's the type of thing that's going to happen. Now, if I go down, I'm depending on one of you, two of you, to just take command. And some of you are natural leaders. And I have to tell you an interesting story. I've learned this. When I was a teenager, I was 15 years old when this happened. I went to high school in Cairo, Egypt, and I was in a pair of taxis where we were driving from the airport back home, and it was a bunch of us teenagers. Four teenage girls in the lead taxi and four of us teenage guys in the following taxi. And as we're driving along, we're following that front taxi. I remember seeing a guy run across into the headlights of that leading taxi, and that taxi just hits him. He flies up smashes the windshield and flies into the air, and the taxi stops. And our taxi stops. And our taxi driver immediately says in English to us, "We must get away, this is a dangerous situation." He starts trying to drive around the situation. And I tell him in Arabic to stop. And he says, "No, no, this is dangerous." And a crowd, just, I don't know where they all came from, but there was 100, 200 people. And they were screaming, and they were yelling, and they were mad. And I just tell our taxi driver, stop, because there are four of my friends are in that taxi in the middle of this belligerent crowd. And I don't know what inside me did this, but I told our taxi driver to stand still. I had my friends go get another taxi, stop and get another taxi. And then me and one other guy walked into that crowd. And I'll never forget when I got to the taxi, looking through the windows of the back seat at these four girls, they were in complete hysterics. And I remember when they saw me, it was just like, you know, suddenly there's hope. And I got them out of the car, and I knew their luggage was in the trunk. Well, I went around to the trunk of the car, and again, I'm pushing through people. The trunk's locked. And I look up, and I can look over the top of the taxi, and I can see the taxi driver. He's standing in the headlights of his car in front of this guy, and at that instant, his friends tried to pick him up, and he was just a complete ragdoll. He was dead. And the guy in Arabic was screaming that, you know, it wasn't his fault, he didn't mean to do it. But I remember walking around the taxi into the headlights, and I walked right up next to him, and in Arabic I just said, "Give me the key." And he's, you know, screaming and yelling, and he just looks at me, reaches in his pocket, and he hands me the key. And I take the key and I walk out through that crowd, get to the trunk, get the luggage out, put the key back in his glove compartment, and put a whole lot of money in the glove compartment, and went right back out through the crowd. But in an emergency situation, somebody in here isn't going to panic. You're going to be level-headed, and you're just going to do it, and other people will follow you what you say. So if I go down, one of you will just take over, and the rest of you will naturally kind of follow, especially if you know already what we're going to do. So two people are going to be calling 911. Those two people are going to be dispatching people to the head office and to the four corners of the building. Those two people are also going to dispatch two people to get the AED and get it back in here. Two people who have CPR training will be attending the person who's down. And they're going to be attending that person who's down for the whole duration until the EMTs get here. Okay? The rest of you, try to clear the area. Try to keep the lab as secure in terms of people coming in, what's happening, that type of stuff. It's going to be noisy. It's going to be loud. We're going to be shouting at each other. We're not going to be shouting angry. We're going to be shouting directions. And to get things done. So, any questions about that? I hope we don't ever have to do this at all, but I want us to be ready. Okay? Now, we talked already about a safety officer. Each lab, we're going to have four students at each lab station. One of the four of you, you'll elect or you'll select to be safety officer. Real easy to do. What's going to happen is I will, each lab, divvy us up into different groups of four each week, because I want each one of you to be working with different people each week. And learn, you get to know each other, but you also learn to work with people that you're not familiar with. Okay, learn how to communicate better, things such as that. You'll select the safety officer, and that safety officer is responsible for the safety of the team. When you're safety officer, I want you looking at the clothing, I want you looking at the feet, I want you to be looking at the power supplies and things like that, and are you using safe procedures? You know, hey, don't touch that, you're still energized. You know, turn off the power supply, that type of thing, okay? Now, there are circuit breakers on these power supplies. And a circuit breaker, there's two of them on here. The main circuit breaker is the one that's kind of in the middle. When I turn that on, you can see the red light comes on that's telling you it's energized. But this is the main breaker, and it subfeeds the other two breakers that are on this power supply. So when you're trying to turn something off, you just turn that off and you de-energized the system. We've got some capacitors in here, but in general, we don't have a lot of charged energy in the capacitors. There's not a lot of charged energy in the labs themselves. When you de-energize here, by and large, we cut power to the situation. Okay. So next week in the lab introduction, each one of you are going to learn how to flip this breaker on. We're also going to have you learn how to unplug the whole power supply from the wall. Going to have each one of you physically do that, because it's a twist and it's a pull. It's not as easy as it feels. But once you do it, you'll remember the motor action and you'll be able to easily do it. I just want each one of you to learn how to do it, physically have done it, so in case something does have to happen, you can do that. So, no, I'm sorry, the control knobs, there are rheostats in here that at the end of every experiment and throughout the experiments, I want you to zero them back down so that when you energize, you're not hitting something with voltage. We can crank the voltage up gradually, okay? So, again, next week we're going to do more with these power supplies. You'll start learning how to use a lot of the equipment, things such as this. Okay, so the mandatory behavior is don't ever clown around in here. We can have fun, we can enjoy each other, we can enjoy things, but no clowning around. This is a serious lab in terms of the standpoint that it's so potentially dangerous. Okay? Then, if you are clowning around in some way that gets my attention or the TA's attention, I'm going to ask you to leave the lab. You're going to get a zero for that day. Okay? I might even have to have a meeting with you afterwards and have you convince me why I should let you back in. Okay? Because it's just that dangerous. I would hate to be in a situation where I allowed a clowning around student back in the lab and somebody gets injured. And I should have had that other kid never come back in. Okay? So, just no clowning around. It's easy. You should be fine. If you're going to repeat something that I don't like, I don't want you in here. And I'm going to have to be convinced as to why I should let you back in. And so that's the way we're going to handle this thing. I mean, it's not zero tolerance, but it's really, really low tolerance, okay? Okay, I just want you to recognize that. Be prepared ahead, beforehand. You know, obviously follow my instructor, the TA instructions. Don't ever turn the power on until you have yourself, you know that you're sick, okay? Remember, you're responsible for your own safety, but the safety of your cohorts at the lab station. Always be ready to turn the power off fast. Now, next week when we do the introduction, you'll see that that's actually pretty easy to do. But the main breaker, you know where the main breaker is, you can turn it off. We also have breakers over here on the panel door on the wall, and if there's something happening at a lab station that we can't safely touch the lab station, that's where we need to be energized, that's a circuit breaker on the wall, okay? Okay, make your connections with one hand. Okay, just learn that, if you're right-handed, left hand behind your back, make your connections. Now you're going to see that there are some times that you do need to use both hands to make connections. Just do it smartly. Watch where your hands are, what your hands are touching, and you can do this lab very, very safely. Okay? Do turn the power off after every use. One of the things that's happening with these power supplies, they're now close to 12 years old, is circuit breakers are only built for so many thousands of operations. And we're turning these breakers on and off, on and off, on and off, all day during this lab, the next lab, and the third lab, next semester. And we've had now two breakers fail. Now, how they fail is when you turn them on, you're going to feel it when you turn it on, is you start to move the handle and you're loading a spring. You can feel a little spring, and it'll actually, if you let go of it, it'll pop back off. As you keep pushing it on, what's happening is you're going to push over top dead center and into a latching position, and you're going to feel that when you do this next week. And the breaker then holds in its on position. Well, what's happening when these breakers fail, that top dead center is getting rounded off and it will not hold itself in its on position and it'll just pop back open. And that's how these breakers are failing. I like that personally. I am so glad that they're failing safe in the open position. So if you have a breaker that you're turning it on and it will not stay in the on position, there's two things that might be happening. First thing, the breaker might be failing. The other thing, though, is you might be closing the breaker into a fault, into a short, and it's doing what it's supposed to do. It's tripping itself open. So if the breaker, if you're turning it on and it is popping back off, step back, look at your wiring. Am I closing into a fault? Is there something going on? Now, what will often happen is that breaker will trip, and that breaker over in the panel board will also trip, and we'll know for sure that you're closing into a short circuit in some way. We're going to take your wiring apart and put it back together correctly. So, I want you to be careful about putting everything away afterwards. Next week, we're going to talk about how we're going to maintain and care for our patch cords. And there's a specific way that I want you to do it, and there's a way I don't want you to do it. Okay, we'll talk about that next week. And then we want you to end up having the lab area neat and clean. Now I'm going to show over here these power supplies are for the meters. And you're going to see that they're just laying on top of the lab bench. When I first came, we had three of these things fail. And where they fail is right at the connector. And I realized what was going on is at the end of every lab, we were putting everything away, we were grabbing the power supply and wrapping the cords around it, and we were basically putting stress here and here. And these things cost about $300 a piece. Fluke really loves these things. So what I want you to do is at the end of every lab, just simply leave it like this, unplug it from the wall if you can. That lab station too, you can't unplug their, it's stuck in the receptacle. But just unplug them and just leave them sitting on top of the lab. And that way these things will last a whole lot longer. We're going to talk a little bit more next week about the CTs that we have and caring for them, because they fail at that connection point also. So there's ways that you can handle the equipment that will increase the longevity of it. Okay, now, this will be another slide I think would be really, really interesting for you next week when we take the quiz. How many of you are familiar with what a ground fault circuit interrupter is? Okay, a few hands. Those of you who are not familiar with them, at home and your hotels and things like that, any place that there is a sink nearby, there will be a device like this. And the reason that they're around sinks is not necessarily because there's water there, but yes, because there's water there, but more importantly, it's what gets the water to that location is the cold water pipe. And in all electrical facilities, the cold water pipe in the building are bonded to the transformers. So there is a circuit from the vicinity of the sink back to the transformer through the cold water pipes. So what this thing does is it's got a white wire, the neutral, a black wire, the hot, green wire is ground. And there is a current sensor inside this device that the white and the black wire go through. And as long as electricity is going from the black wire into the white wire, that current probe is measuring the magnetic field induced by the current flow. If everything going in the black is coming out the white, what's the net current measurement by that probe? Zero. But if you have current somehow flowing from the black wire to the green wire, now does that CT see a balance anymore? It sees an imbalance. Very important number to remember for next week. If it sees an imbalance of 5 milliamps or more, it will trip open. And it will trip open very, very fast. Remember, one of the things in the human body is duration of the shock. What a ground fault circuit interrupter does is it trips open at 5 milliamps or higher fast enough that the duration of this current going through the human body, generally adult human beings will survive. But interestingly enough, 5 milliamps, infants and young children, it could be dangerous. But you start getting below that 5 milliamp threshold and your hair dryers will trip it, your electric drills will trip it, and there's different things that have enough leakage beyond 5 milliamps or below 5 milliamps that you'll get nuisance tripping. So, just know as electrical engineers, that was a compromised number that was decided that the vast majority of the human population will survive a 5 milliamp short duration shock of 120 volts across the body. Interesting point. Probably none of you will need this data. I learned it one time and I'll just pass it on. If you use a ground fault circuit interrupter in an agricultural situation with pigs, say you have an electric heater in a water trough that you want to keep the water thawed in the wintertime so the pigs have, you know, liquid water to drink, and you have some kind of a line to ground fault and you're protecting it with a ground fault circuit interrupter, 5 milliamps will kill a pig dead. So can't use a ground fault circuit interrupter to protect a pig. Cows, yeah, cows will do it. Interestingly, a cow goes up to a water trough, puts its snout in the water to drink. If it feels a tingle of electricity, that cow will never, he'll back away from the water and never come back to that trough again. He will die of thirst before he ever puts his snout back in that water. So the agricultural business in electricity, it's a whole different type of scenario to protect animals and livestock in farm situations. And just something that's interesting about this. So, ground fault circuit interrupter, 5 milliamps. Remember you have 5 digits on your finger, 5 milliamps, okay? Give you a hint about a question next week. Okay. Reed, are you done? Wow, that's great thinking.
They did all the work.
They did it well.
She was.
Oh, but thank you guys. I want us to take a 5-minute break, and then we're going to talk about lightning safety. Okay? And again, there's some things that we're going to cover in this next portion about lightning safety that are going to be covered in the quiz next week. So, and then at the end of this, we're also then going to take what we know about electricity and look at some events that have taken place in the news about people who have been killed in electrical accidents and talk about and analyze what happened and what can we learn from the situation. So let's take a quick 5-minute break and we'll start again. All right, we're going to talk about lightning safety, and we're going to talk some about the physics and the theory behind what causes lightning, and then talk about how is that impacting us living on the surface of the earth and what's happening up in the clouds up above us. Now, we're going to start off how lightning changed the world. How many of you know who Martin Luther King was? Not Junior, but Martin Luther King. Okay, read this story. This is fascinating. Lightning bolt changed the world. It took place near Stotterheim in Germany, 1505. Free-spirited law student Martin Luther, walking home, he was a little bit inebriated, and was changed his life when a lightning strike hit nearby him and knocking the concussion of the shockwave, knocked him on the ground, scared him a lot to death, scared him a lot. And he cried out and made a vow in his mind that he was going to become a monk, forget this attorney business, I'm going to become a monk. And to his dad's chagrin, he gives up the law degree and goes into the monastery, and then the whole world changed from the stand of Christianity and what his impact was on Christianity, all because of a lightning bolt. And I don't know if any of you have even heard that story. That is just fascinating. Fascinating. Okay. Now, who did Benjamin Franklin? Tell us, what did Benjamin Franklin do with lightning?
He invented the lightning.
Talk loud.
He invented the lightning rod, and that was one of his earlier inventions.
Right.
And then also the experiment with the kite and the key, and determining the charge of a thunderstorm. He used wool to determine that it was negatively charged.
Okay. That the bottom of the cloud was negatively charged. Okay. So, Franklin is just fascinating what he did as an amateur scientist doing world-caliber work in his day of lightning. And basically, we talked a little bit about him last night, but he's the one that's responsible for giving the electron the negative charge. Again, he just did it by accident, had a 50-50 chance of getting it right. I wish he'd have given it a positive charge, but okay, it is what it is. And he started working on how to protect buildings from lightning. And he developed a system by which he would take sharpened copper rods and stick them up on the side of a structure so that the tip was higher than any other part of the building. And then he would connect a copper wire from the end of that and bring it down into the dirt. And you're going to hear me use the term into the dirt, into the soil, because literally that's what it is. We talk about grounding systems. Grounding systems ultimately go out and touch the soil. There's a rod that goes right into the dirt. And it seems primitive, it seems weird, but boy, it works really good. So, anyway, Franklin developed this system to protect the structure and protect livestock. And to this very day, we refer to lightning protection systems as Franklin rod systems. And very, very common parlance, Franklin rod system, all invented back in the 1700s by Benjamin Franklin. So, real quickly, especially here on the Front Range, and as you mature as engineers, as you graduate and get out into the world, you should observe what happens around here for lightning events. The Front Range of Colorado is the second highest incidence of lightning in North America. And the higher incidence of lightning is along the Gulf Coast, and the north central Florida is the hot spot for lightning. And what's basically happening here is clouds come off of the Front Range, off of the mountains, and because then the terrain changes, the atmosphere drops. And that change in elevation causes air movement, causes more turbulence, and causes a heightened amount of lightning right within 15 miles of the foothills. You get out 25 miles and on out into the eastern, it's back down to normal light levels, lightning levels. So what basically happens with the cumulonimbus cloud, and watch one, you know, in next summer, if you've got some time, you know, just observe it. What you'll see is that about 11 o'clock in the morning, the clouds start to build up and they start to cluster together. And what will happen is one side of the cloud will be hit by the sunlight, and it'll kind of warm up the water vapor in the cloud right there. The other side of the cloud will be in shadow, eastern side. You start getting a differential in temperature. One side starts going up, the other side starts going down, and you get movement and turbulence. That turbulence will actually start then building a cloud. On the cold side, cold air is going to come in and start mixing. Warm air is going to be coming in from the other side, and usually warm air has more solubility for water vapor. Warm air is usually much more humid than cold air. So now you've got warm, humid air and cold, drier air mixing, you get precipitation. But the magic thing that happens in lightning is that someplace between the ground and up here, you have the change in temperature to freezing. And you've got water vapor below it, and you have ice crystals above it. And there's where the magic starts occurring, is those ice crystals collide with each other. And as they collide with each other, due to static electricity, one ice crystal will end up with an extra electron, one will end up without an electron. You now have a charge difference between the two crystals, and it's the wind turbulence that's forcing them to separate so that that electron can't jump back home. What happens is with this warm updraft, the net effect is that the top of the cloud ends up with the predominance of the charged ice crystals that are one charge. The bottom of the cloud has a different charge. So you end up with a potential difference from the bottom of the cloud to the top of the cloud. Now, that's basically what I'm describing here, but here's what happens that affects us down on the ground. Now, physics tells us there's always a net zero electrical charge in any system. And in a cloud lightning system, it is a net zero charge. And the Earth is part of the system. So from the Earth up to the cloud, net zero charge. But we already know we've got a potential difference between the top of the cloud and the bottom of the cloud. Well, what happens is then from the bottom of the cloud to the soil, that potential difference causes a charge to occur in the surface of the Earth. And it's not in the top 20 feet, it's in the top 3 to 4 feet of the soil. Okay? So that is what is happening, which is causing this potential to occur. Now, this is a great photo. What's happening then is from the bottom of the cloud to the surface of the ground, there's now a charge potential. There's also a charge potential from the bottom of the cloud to the top of the cloud. But when the charge potential from the bottom of the cloud to the ground reaches a significant value, enough that the electricity will jump from the bottom of the cloud to the soil, you have lightning cloud to ground lightning. Now, why doesn't it just dissipate within the cloud? And just cloud to cloud lightning? Part of the reason is what's the height of the top of the cumulonimbus cloud here in the Great Plains?
Like 50,000 to 80,000 feet.
50,000 feet, what's the elevation of the bottom of the cloud here on the Front Range? 10,000 feet. So the distance from the bottom of the cloud to the top of the cloud, maybe 60,000 feet, 50,000 feet, 40,000 feet. What's the distance from the bottom of a cloud at 10,000 feet elevation to the soil?
2,003.
4,000 to 5,000 feet. So lightning's trying to equalize its net zero potential. Is it going to jump 3,000 to 4,000 feet, or is it going to try to jump 30,000 feet? So what will happen is you have lightning that goes from the bottom of the cloud into the soil. And so here's where things get a little bit more interesting. As this is happening, at time zero, before a lightning event's actually taking place, there is a charge that is occurring between the bottom of the cloud and the top of the cloud. And electrons are actually being exchanged invisibly just through the atmosphere. It's just not in enough quantity to actually dissipate the potential difference between the bottom of the cloud and the soil. And what will happen is that invisibly there will be liters and regions in the atmosphere. It's undulating, it's moving, it's very, very, very dynamic, but you'll get one of these that will come together and coincidentally happen in a similar place, so the net resistance through the air at that particular location is suddenly a lot less. And now suddenly the whole field, the whole charge from the surface of the ground to the bottom of the cloud will all collapse into that one vicinity and create a lower impedance path that's low enough to pow, you'll get a discharge of lightning. And the reason that trees and tall structures get involved is that trees are much better conductors than air, large buildings better conductors than air, and so that place where the lower impedance path just happens to occur generally occurs around tall structures, tall trees, especially if they're conductive, okay? So knowing that, is it better to be on top of a 14,000 footer, or further down away from the peak of the mountaintop? It's clearly you want to be away from the ridge of the mountain, especially if you're up above tree line and you're the only salt-filled bag of water on the mountaintop. Okay? So, a little bit of interest here. 30 million volts to jump that big of an air gap, 100,000 amps. In general, here in Colorado, we're probably around the 10,000 to 30,000 amp range. And it's just because the lightning's only jumping 3,000 to 4,000 feet. When you're up above the tree line, it's only jumping a few hundred feet sometimes, so it's not a lot of amplitude to make that jump. You get in north central Florida, if the bottom of the cloud is at roughly probably 6,000 feet there, you know, it's jumping a greater distance. It takes a whole lot of potential, a lot more potential to jump that distance. So a lot heavier, more robust lightning in north central Florida than what's happening here. So, you know, 54,000 degrees for a lightning stroke. And
what's happening when we get hurt by lightning is clearly, if you're standing and you're part of the conductive path, you're carrying this amount of current, you're dead. There is a third degree burn path through you that is completely hollowed out, and it is cauterized and it is solidified. You're pretzeled from top to bottom along that path, whatever it was that went through you, and you're dead. Okay. Well, if you weren't in the path, it's nearby, you could get hit by what's called a side flash. So in that instant that it's hitting, say, the tree next to you, you're still a better conductor from the top of your head to the tree than the air around you. So you could actually carry a little bit of current near you. Now, what will happen, there's a thing called the skin effect. We'll talk a little bit more skin effect in future labs. But it might be that the electricity flows around the sweat on the outside of your body rather than through your internal organs or something like that. You could get a bit of what we call a side flash. And most people who survive a lightning strike don't realize it, but they've been hit by a side flash, not the main bolt of lightning. That's why they survived it. Now the next thing that happens, if you're in the vicinity of a lightning bolt, clearly you're going to hear the concussion. Now what makes the sound of thunder? What's actually physically causing the sound?
The superheated air moving through.
That's right. The superheated air is causing a compression wave of the expanding hot gas. And then what happens as soon as the lightning strike extinguishes, now the air comes back, you get a compaction and a rarefaction, and you get, our ear will pick up two actual sounds from that. Now, along the entire 4,000 foot length of that lightning shaft, it's three-dimensional, it's very undulating. Each one of those points in time up there are generating the sound, and it traveling 740 miles an hour, and it takes time for the 4,000 foot part of that lightning strike for its sound to get to your ear. Clearly the one that's right here close by, you're hearing it right now, but that's why you hear thunder seems to rumble and seems to last a long time. It's just because it all happened at the same instant. It's just taking longer for the sound at the top to get to you than the sound at the bottom to get to you. Okay? So, the next thing that's happening is the superheated air around the lightning shaft will cause people to have that startle reflex and inhale. And there are many people who have been hit by lightning do have lung damage from the superheated air, that involuntary reflex, and you can't stop that from happening. The best thing to do in lightning is to make sure that you're not in the vicinity where it's going to be possibly happening, okay? So here is a annual flash rate climatology for the whole planet, and here's look at Florida, man. And then we are up here. I think we're this spot right here, a little bit of an orange spot. Again, we have a lot of lightning events here in terms of quantity, but the magnitude is lower here on the Front Range. There's a lot of them happening. That's Mount Kilimanjaro in Central Africa. But look at Europe, where the Europeans who were moving in the early 1700s from Europe into North America, they were going from a very benign lightning environment to relatively robust one. That's why it was catching people like Benjamin Franklin by surprise, is what is this phenomenon and what can we do about it? The other thing is, look at Japan over here. In general, now I can't quantify this, but I just look at this map and I go, if I'm going to buy a product for lightning protection that's manufactured in North Central Florida versus a lightning protection package that's built in Japan, I bet the one in Florida works better. And just knowing what I see on this map. And there are a lot of good products for lightning protection that originated in Florida, things that work. There's a whole lot of products that are coming out of Japan that purport to be good lightning protection systems, but there's not ever been a lot of good, sound, fundamental, scientifically based analysis of their effectiveness. And they can't prove that they're any more effective than a Franklin rod system. So I use Franklin rod systems because the Franklin rod system, you get a UL listing for it. And insurance companies and attorneys really like UL listing. They really are very interested in lawsuits when you're specifying something that isn't UL listed and then something fails. So, free advice. So, number of thunderstorm days a year, you know, look at Florida, the Gulf region, you know, our little hot spot where we are. This is, I'm going to skip this one. One more here. This is the National NFPA, National Fire Protection Association, their standard 780. Their map, their isochronic map of North America. Again, you can see the coast and lightning levels of 10. Here, you know, our little hot spot, again, occurring where we are. And again, it's just really just right along the front range, just right here in this big population area of Fort Collins down to Pueblo, is where a lot of this happens, right where we're building our buildings. Now, effects on people. Now, this photograph is a time photograph, but this was taken in Colorado Springs. Isn't that incredible? The city of Colorado Springs will often announce how many lightning strikes they've had. And when they have a thunderstorm, they'll sometimes get 360 lightning strikes to their system within an hour. And just amazing. So, effects on people is, you know, clearly direct strike, we've talked about that. Side flash, where it's a lower amplitude. There are earth currents, which is where the most danger is. Hearing loss from the percussion on the ear burns. And then another one, musicophilia. How many of you, everybody forgot his name. There was a neuropsychologist, and he just passed away this past year. Wrote a book. The title of the book is Musicophilia. And it's a book about people who changed and how they changed neurologically from being struck by lightning. Now, I'll think of the guy's name tonight, too. God rest his soul. Anyway, this book, he talks about one particular guy who in his 40s was just normal average, and let's say he was an accountant. Just a nobody special, nobody interesting at all. He gets hit by a side flash of lightning and recovers in the hospital, and he comes out of the hospital and, you know, he's been injured. But he gets home, and he just really starts thinking about, he used to play, you know, a horn in band. And he goes, well, where did my horn go? So he finds his horn. And he just really feels like playing his horn a lot. And he really feels like he really wants to learn how to play a piano. It turns out he's really good at playing the piano. He, you know, learns it really fast, and he really now likes to compose music. And something happened in his brain that neurologically some connections that were naturally there got enhanced as a result of this lightning event that he experienced. And he turned into a savant in music just overnight. From being hit by lightning. Now, I wish, you know, if I could get a side flash, I'd like to be really good at math. You know, or something like that. But anyway, just some interesting things that happen to people who survived lightning events, and it's all happening neurologically in the brain. It's a great, great, great book, Musicophilia. If you look it up, it's a good read. Let's talk a little bit more about some of these things here. Now, the lightning effects on a structure,
This is Bartlesville, Oklahoma. A guy in Broken Arrow, Oklahoma, took these pictures, and I got permission, Dave Crowley. And the reason I don't present these images to you guys in PDF format is some of these pictures I don't have permission from the original artist who took them. So I just simply use them here in an academic function, but I don't publish them in some way. Anyway, you look at the photograph here. We've got a tall building, we have a cell phone tower, we have horizon here, cloud up above, and there's a lot of cloud to ground lightning taking place. And the reason I show this to you is that there's several things happening to this building as we're sitting here. Clearly, the building could be hit by a direct strike, but that's a very low probability, actually. The building could be hit by a side flash. If you're looking at this photograph, here are side flashes that are coming from the electrons that are in the atmosphere that are traveling up that are suddenly wanting to collapse to this location of the lower impedance path. That's the actual lightning bolt itself. Look at the photograph on my the background at all of these electrical leads that are just blowing out into the air. They're not stopping. What's happening is all of this current is actually occurring invisibly out in the atmosphere over here. It just happens that it congeals to a point that it becomes incandescent and we can see it. So there are currents that are following this shadow cloud, this shadow charge that's underneath the cloud. Those earth currents are traveling to the spots on the soil where that lightning is hitting. So at this instant, there's electrons being exchanged in the top of the cloud, or the bottom of the cloud, excuse me, but there are also electrons and there's current flowing in the soil, in that top 3 feet of the soil, underneath the cloud. Now, just right before this lightning event took place, there was a higher charge at the top of that building than on the ground, because the building is conductive. What's happening in this instant, all of the charge that was here is now traveling down the steel of the building, getting into the soil and traversing in the soil to the point where the lightning is hitting the ground. So there's actually current flowing in that building. And when we design buildings, we have to keep in mind that we've got to protect our building from bound charge as well as a direct lightning strike. And a Franklin rod system will not help you with bound charge. Franklin rod system will protect you from a direct strike. Now the next thing that's happening is all of you have been driving in your car with your radio on during a lightning storm and you hear that puff, that static sound on your radio. What's happening is that as that current is flowing through the atmosphere, it is creating a magnetic field. And there's an electromagnetic pulse that emanates from the lightning strike. You can pick it up in your radio, but if you're in close proximity to a lightning bolt, that EMP pulse is incredibly strong. It's strong enough to actually destroy electronics. It'll ballistically move the conductors in the printed circuit board and crack the circuit board, break it, break the connections, destroy it. It just won't work anymore. You might not even see it, but it has happened. That's what an electromagnetic pulse will do. And then the cross-coupled currents. As the bound charge flows down that building, any kind of conductor that's parallel to that pathway, you'll get cross-coupled currents onto the wire, and now the wire is carrying current, just because of the induced current of the steel next to it. And if that wire is going to a computer, into a data network, into a printed circuit board, something that's sensitive, you can actually destroy and break the electronics inside a building. And so a building, you can have damage, and it had never been struck by lightning at all. So, in a cloud-to-cloud lightning event, you have this shadow charge that's in the surface of the soil that is opposite the charge of the bottom of the cloud. Generally, the bottom of clouds are negatively charged
The tops of clouds are positively charged, which means you've got a positive shadow charge in the soil. But in a complex lightning event, you can actually flip that and have a positive charge bottom, negatively charged soil. I mean, generally it starts negative bottom of cloud, more electrons at the bottom of the cloud, okay? So here's this bound charge flowing down a building, and in lightning, cloud-to-cloud lightning, the charge change here causes a reflected proportional change in the shadow charge in the soil below. So no lightning stroke from cloud to earth, but lightning currents occurring in the surface of the earth. You can't see it. Your electrical systems absolutely will detect it and have to respond to it in some way. When I first was introduced to this, it was down in Colorado Springs. There was a juvenile detention center right down on Fountain Creek. And there's some railroad lines that go right down through there. And this facility hired me to come in and do some lightning abatement with them because they kept having their systems, their detention systems, their fence security systems just fail, just stop working. And, you know, I asked, well, was there a direct strike? No, we don't have a direct strike, no evidence of direct strike and all this. And I finally realized that what's happening is in that particular spot, they're right by Monument Creek, might be Fountain Creek down there. So it's moist, and these railroad lines that go all the way up to Wyoming, all the way down to New Mexico, and those rail lines were giving us this low impedance path for these earth currents within 100 feet of this building where all the damage was occurring. So you don't have to have a strike, a lightning strike, cloud to earth to get enough amplitude of current flowing in the soil to cause damage to your systems. So in a cloud-to-cloud lightning event, and 85% of all lightning is cloud-to-cloud, you've got no direct strike. You will always have bound charge on top of high conductive structures. And again, bound charge takes place. The current flows down the structure at the instant that the lightning is occurring in the cloud, flows down into the soil to help dissipate the exchange of charge from the shadow charges in this top of soil. There's always this high probability of earth currents. And then you've got your magnetic pulse just simply from the lightning bolt occurring in the cloud just a few thousand feet away. Okay? In this photograph, we're over a lake. You can see there's a horizon line off beyond, and then this huge lightning event taking place. But just know that in the water, there is the exact amount of current flowing in this water. It's not happening in confined spots that we would recognize as a lightning strike. It's happening in sheets of flow of current. So the cross-sectional area at any point, you could say the current density is much lower than the current density right there, for example, but the same net zero effect is still happening. But the same amount of the electrons that are occurring here, the negative charge is happening here. Okay? Does that make sense? A lot of engineers don't ever think that this is what's going on. Okay, so cloud-to-cloud lightning, little diagram, oops, cloud-to-ground lightning. So now you've got a lightning bolt hitting the ground. We've already talked about this phenomenon. The bound charge is going to have electrons flowing down a tall building, traversing to the point where the lightning is hitting the ground. And what we're going to be interested in is what's happening right here, because there's a lot more significant amplitude or significant magnitude things happening here. How many of you have seen Dr. Emmerman's presentation on the soccer game where lightning hit the field? Okay, so you've seen the event that none of those guys got hit by lightning, but about 8 or 9 of them went down, were affected. And they were affected by step potential. So, in ground-to-cloud lightning, there's always a low probability of an actual direct strike. Here's a photograph. This is a building. This lightning bolt is happening miles beyond this structure. But all of these structures are not getting hit by lightning. So the reality is it's a low probability that your building's actually going to get hit by lightning. The greater probability is that there's always bound charge and there's always earth currents. Always. So when we design our buildings, we need to make sure that we're thinking about protecting the building from that. So, even when the strike is occurring at a distance, the radio towers and things such as that get the EMP and the pulse on them, and your phone lines and overhead power lines will sometimes carry what we call transients. And basically, though, as these currents are flowing around, they'll follow conductive paths, and they'll follow the neutrals of a power line to get cross-coupled onto the phase conductors in the power line, things such as that. And the utility system has a very barbaric way of dealing with transients on their power lines. They have a thing called a recloser. How many of you have heard of the term recloser? Okay, I see one hand down here. What it is a big, medium voltage, high voltage switch that detects a transient. And as soon as it detects a transient, the switch opens. Boom. As soon as it opens, it de-energizes everything that it was powering up. And the idea is that it opens, the transient is able to dissipate into the soil, and the event stops. After 1.5 seconds, 2 seconds, the recloser will close back, boom, re-energize everything, everybody gets their electricity back. So when you're at home, during a lightning event, and the electricity goes out, and then it comes back on, 1.5, 2 seconds later, what you're experiencing is not a lightning event, you're experiencing the utility's recloser protecting the distribution system, the transmission system, from the lightning event. Now, how these reclosers are designed is the recloser closes back down. If it still detects a transient, it will open up again. So now you've had it happen twice. All your computers started rebooting the first time. They just got zapped with a restrike, I mean with a restart. They go off again. Recloser waits 1.5, 2 seconds how it's programmed. It recloses. If the transient is still there, the third time, it will open and it will stay open. And it will not close until there are boots on the ground to go to someplace and press a button that says close. And that's one reason why you're experiencing in lightning storms these multiple short outages and then power is off. You're experiencing the programmed, predetermined operation of a utility recloser. I wish they would come up with a different way to protect, because in our world of computers, you know, a few milliseconds of power outage and the system drops power and you're hot rebooting, and it just plays havoc in the commercial world with computers. But that's why we have generators, that's why we have UPS systems and all of that, is to fight against the utility recloser doing what it's supposed to do. By the way, utility company will not call that a power outage. That's natural functioning of their system, so that is not a power outage. Even though for you it's a power outage. For sure it's a power outage. Okay, so we talk a little bit about the EMP and the point where the lightning bolt is hitting. This uses the term as a rise in ground potential. But what's happening is current is flowing through the soil. Whenever you have current flowing, you then have a voltage potential between point A and point B. If you had a meter out there, you can measure voltage just simply because there's current flowing through it. You have a voltage that's there. So, in the electrical field, electricians are taught about touch potential and step potential. And they show that if you have a 240 volt line that's energized somehow right next to a pole, that as you walk up to the pole, you've got a distance between your feet. And the electricity is flowing in the soil, and there's a point in time where the distance between your feet and the resistance is that the current flowing through your body exceeds that 50 milliamps, and now your body's going to start reacting. And so they teach electricians what to do and how to approach something like this. Now, did you ever have any training on step potential?
No.
No? What they'll do in the utility industry is they will tell people, you know, the pole is here, you take small steps, or you take one step at a time, you have 1 foot on the ground at a time, something like that. Really, they're telling them, get away, you know, don't be close. Usually, it's not that you're approaching it, you're trying to get way away as fast as you can. And they teach them either hop, or step 1 foot at a time in terms of running away, but keep your butt facing where the pole is and go straight away from it. And what you're doing is trying to get away from the step potential. Now, in a lightning event, you're not talking 240 volts here, you're talking thousands of volts. And the distance, the greater distance you are away from the actual place where the lightning is hitting the ground, the safer you are. But to get to that threshold, to get down, you need to be a long way from where the actual lightning is hitting the soil. When I prepared this, I looked at, you know, different photographs that are available online, and there were several photographs. I remember one in particular, this beautiful green tree in the middle of a grassy field, and probably 12 dead cows all around the bottom of the tree. And the caption underneath the photograph said, the farmer could find no damage to the tree, so how these cattle died, I have no idea. And I know exactly what killed them. It was earth currents, and there wasn't enough of an amplitude of strike in the actual tree to do damage to the tree, but enough earth currents traveling through the soil to the spot that went through the cows and killed them. They weren't directly struck by lightning themselves. Now here's a formula you don't need to have, but it's a formula that relates to how far apart your feet are, to the distance you are from the place where the electricity is flowing in the ground. And we're going to talk about that this phenomenon does not just happen with lightning. It also happens whenever you have a downed power line that is in contact with the soil. In the vicinity of the downed power line, there's a heightened step potential, and you've got to be really, really careful when you've got power lines on the ground, because unbeknownst to you, there are currents flowing in the soil, and it basically gives you some idea. Now, if you look at this, here's S and here's D plus S, but if V is here and S is above that, as S gets down closer and closer to zero, the amplitude of the voltage potential goes down proportionally. So if S were zero, then this formula V would be what?
Zero.
So if you've got your feet together, that's a whole lot better condition to be in than if you got your feet apart, right? So keep that in mind. So, back to looking at the cloud, the events going on. We know that cloud-to-cloud events taking place, there's shadow charge exchange of current. We know cloud-to-ground events, that again, shadow charge, there's an exchange of current, and there are currents that flow in the surface of the soil, invisibly. So, again, the lightning dangers, you know, direct strike, very, very low probability, a little bit higher probability, side flashes, always ground currents, always. Always step voltage that are in the vicinity of the strike itself. And cross-coupled currents can induce problems into your building, electromagnetic pulse, and then heat, start a fire, burn things up. Now, you as electrical engineers are in a very unique position in our society that you understand electricity more than the average person. So you as an electrical engineer, when you get out into the world and you're interacting with people that are not as educated as you are, recognize that you're in a spot that you can help people with safety on their part and understanding how to stay safe, okay? And at home they say do not turn on the television. Well, this was in an era when this was here that you actually had an on-off switch on the TV set that was an air switch. It actually made an air gap and you'd completely isolate the TV set from the electrical distribution system. Well, today, all of the TV sets that you have are in a solid-state switch, and they are still energized. Probably the best thing if you have a $5,000 TV set, plasma display, unplug the sucker. Or get a power strip, you can just click off the power strip and disconnect it. But, you know, listen to the radio, your smartphone, you can get onto your weather apps and things like that to see what's going on. Unplug your appliances, any kind of appliance that you really cherish, that you love dearly, if you've got time, unplug it, okay? Avoid using a landline phone. Why should you avoid using a landline phone?
The landline could carry a current, and then it could go through you back into the ground.
Yeah, exactly right. Exactly right. There are lawsuit examples in New York City in like high towers, like Empire State Building, where the building's been struck by lightning, and the Empire State Building gets struck by lightning multiple times a year since it's tall. People inside the building on their phone get a discharge from the phone to their ear and cause ear damage, cause neural damage, things such as that. So avoid using landline. But it's okay to use a cell phone. Why is it okay to use a cell phone?
No physical connection.
Yeah, it's as simple as that. Okay? Stay away from faucets, sinks, and bathtubs. Why should you stay away from faucets, sinks, and bathtubs?
Because cold water pipes connect to your ground.
Exactly right. Cold water pipe is the problem. Now, the reason we do a cold water pipe again is that from an overall safety standpoint, it's far better to have the cold water pipes connected to the soil, connected back to the transformer, for a low impedance pass so you can trip breaker and stop the electrical faults from happening. The problem is that in a lightning event, it is a conductive path that's in close proximity to where people will be touching it. Okay? Keep away from windows. Why should you stay away from windows?
And blast from there could blow in the window.
In a generally in a building, if lightning actually hits the building, lightning is going to be taking whatever conductive paths it has down to the soil. If you're standing near a window, you are a bag of salt water. You are a better conductor than the glass and the wood frame that's right there. And you can actually be hit by a side flash standing inside the building. Now you're also near the perimeter of the building, which is closer to the soil, which is where the lightning is trying to get to anyway. So it's just better to stay away from windows. Should you go out on the front porch that's covered up with water falling down and watch the lightning storm? Probably not. But have I ever done it? Yeah, I've done it a lot. I'm interested in lightning. I'm interested in seeing it. But anyway, keep away from windows. Now, outdoors. And this is where you can come in and really help the population a lot. Because there's a lot. Our population in Colorado loves to get out and hike in the summertime, be outdoors a lot. And you hear a lot every summer about people injured by lightning, and unfortunately, some people killed by lightning. And you listen to the events and what's going on, and I often go, well, had they known what I know, they maybe could have avoided getting themselves in the circumstance that they were in. Now, when you're doing, how many of you have climbed 14ers? Okay. So, where are you supposed to be after 12 o'clock climbing a 14er?
going down. Oh, no,
we don't. That's right. Now, why is that?
Storm started around like 12 to 2.
That's right. More lightning events are occurring early and mid-afternoon, so you do all your 14er climbing in the morning. Now, if you're from Minnesota and you're coming to Colorado and you've gone to Rocky Mountain National Park and this is the most beautiful experience you've ever had, we slept in, we got up, we had lunch, and now we're going to go drive Trail Ridge Road and get out and hike and take pictures of the foxes or the coyotes off in the distance and all this. Does anybody tell you that after 12 o'clock there's more chance for lightning? No. The answer is no. A lot of people that are coming and visiting our state don't know. So we need to try to help inform them that generally try not to be out exposed above tree line after midnight, after lunch, especially if there's clouds. Now, if you remember last year on which mountain was it? Horstadt? There was a group of people at 11 o'clock in the morning got hit by lightning, and the guy's dog was killed, and I think there was another guy killed, but the one guy had his dog right up next to him, and the dog was killed, and he survived it. But they said that what happened to them was that it was just blue sky, and they're just about to summit, and suddenly they said this cloud just came right up over the top of them, and blue electricity crackling on the rocks around them, and pow, just that fast. And so they were doing everything right, they just got caught by a low probability event. So anyway, if you're near a pinnacle, think about the fact that the pinnacle is where the potential from the bottom of the cloud is going to be the least, I mean at the most, and the distance is going to be the least. So the ridge line is where you want to try to stay away from. So you want to try to get a distance about 1.5 to 1 times your height below the bottom of the pinnacle away from the pinnacle. So you want to try to get away from the ridge line. The next thing, you want to avoid caves and overhangs unless they're completely dry. Usually here in Colorado, caves and overhangs are natural drainage places and they're moist. Moist ground will conduct these earth currents a lot better than dry ground. And your enemy, once you get away from the direct strike, now your enemy are the earth currents that are going to be traveling up there. Now, the tuck lightning position. How many of you have ever heard of the tuck lightning position? Okay, some of you, so describe it.
You're supposed to keep your feet together, knees bent, and you have your hands out. That's what I heard. Okay, well, cover your ears and then like squat down a little low. If you're like feet together and knees apart, it's that way. Well, covering your ears, because if you get struck by lightning, I forgot, if you get struck by lightning, it's done.
Yeah, it's protecting your ears from the sound of it. Generally, the tech lightning, I've got a photograph, I got a picture later, it's a diagram of it, but basically, you're going to put your feet together, and you're going to crouch down and get your height above the ground as low as you can. So you'll kind of, you know, bend your head down to, you know, close to your knees. But what you don't want to do, you don't want to stick your hands out. Keep your hands, you know. If you imagine yourself as this conductive bag of salt water, you're trying to get yourself as low as you can with your feet together. Again, if you get that step distance to zero, even if there are earth currents traveling underneath you, generally, there's not going to be enough voltage to hurt you. Should you put your hands on the ground? No. Again, you put your hands on the ground, now you've increased that S value to 12 inches, whatever. There's some distance there. Okay? Other things? If you find yourself above tree line and your hair is standing up, or you're seeing, you know, electricity popping around, the first thing you need to do is get in the tuck lightning position. But you want to get in a tuck lightning position in a place where there's a low probability that the earth currents are going to affect you. So on top of a stone, boulder is probably not the right word here, but on top of a stone that's sitting on top of other rocks. And generally what will happen is that stone is sitting on other rocks. The point of contact to that stone are points. So they'll conduct less electricity than the area around. Now, will you have time to find that? Maybe, maybe not. Usually, it catches you by surprise that your hair is standing up and you realize, I'm in a spot where the potential of a lightning strike is now. I need to do something now. What you should have been doing before that is getting down the hill like you're supposed to, summit and get down in below a tree line as quick as you can. You want to stay away from taller trees. As you get down, as you're de-summiting and trying to get away from a lightning event, get into the forest, but as you're getting into the forest, look, find the tall trees and go, okay, well, when I get into there, I want to stay away from there and there. Okay, don't necessarily just follow the trail. The trail was put in there for ease of access, not thinking about lightning events, so just be smart. If you're on an athletic field, think about all of the objects that can conduct electricity. The metal backstops of a baseball field. Incredibly conductive. You don't want to be in a dugout. So you need to be thinking about, well, what would you do? And they have the Little League actually has brochures for coaches as to what to do with students. And one of the first things they do is, first time you hear a rumble, you cancel the game, you get all the kids in their cars with mom and dad and tell them to go home, we'll finish the game later. That's one of the first things they tell you, and that's great advice, actually. But if you find you're in a lightning event that's happening right now, probably the safest place would be out someplace around second base, with all the kids maybe 5 or 6 feet away from each other, crouched down in the lightning position, but away from the backstops, because that's where that current, the earth current, is going to be concentrated, near those steel poles where they touch the dirt. Okay? In the middle of an open field, you know, get into a low-lying area and assume that tucked lightning position. Do you want to get into a ditch with water in the bottom of the ditch? Okay. Good. Now, if you're away from home and you're on or near the water, get to land and get to safety. Clear if you're out on Dillon Reservoir, metal boat, having life, enjoying it, got your spinnaker mast sticking up in the air, you know, you idiot. you know, watch what's going on. Just be smart, get away, be safe. Choosing between a building or a car, choose the building. Now, this would be a building that has walls and a roof and doors. If this is an open picnic structure, yeah, man, try your car. Get in the car. Now, choosing between a hard top and a convertible. How many know what a hard top is? Just real quick, I'm finding my nomenclature. Okay, you guys know what a hard top is. Okay. Choose the hard top. You know, convertible, that mat over the top of you, that's not going to give you any protection at all. Remember, the lightning's already jumping a few thousand feet. A little bit of fabric isn't going to help at all. If you have a car, keep the windows closed. If there's no shelter, find a low-lying, open place, safe, a distance from trees, poles, or metal objects that will be conducting electricity. Then don't lie flat on the ground. Why should you not lie flat on the ground?
Because S would be 4 or 5.
Or 6.
6.
Yeah. You know, I knew when I showed you guys that formula, you'd look at the formula and go, I understand that. I know math. So, see, there's a reason why you took differential equations. Okay, so, tuck lightning position. What I don't like about this image, his head should be down, his feet really ought to be more close together, but it's really hard. If you put yourself in this position, it's really hard to stay balanced. So, you know, I'd rather be 3 inches here than 12 or 13, but just know, getting that a good solid tuck position, you can stay that way for a while. Okay? So we've talked about lightning dangers and summarized them before. Now, I want to apply some of what we know. I keep track in the media of events that take place where there's tragic electrocutions, and I read the stories and I go, well, I analyze, well, what happened? We're going to look at some of those things. And here's one that a crash scene turns tragic. And there are some good Samaritans who are electrocuted trying to save a person who's in a car accident involving an electrical power pole. And happened in Burbank, California. Two women died Wednesday in what witnesses described as a bizarre, tragic series of events. Basically, what happened, the next shot, is a photograph that was taken of the event. There's a car that hit a power pole. The power pole is not evident here, but she ran over a fire hydrant on her way to the power pole. The fire hydrant then is spewing water and creating a giant pool puddle, and the overhead power line was knocked loose and fell into the puddle. So now the puddle is energized. The woman still in the car, she's actually not in the circuit, but she's in the car, she's injured. These good Samaritans stepped into the water to try to get to her car, and they were electrocuted. And two people died, and there were firefighters that arrived on scene, and they were also shocked, but they recognized what was happening, and they backed away, and they actually had to wait until the utility company de-energized the overhead power line. So, where was the electricity coming from? The power line. Where was the circuit? Where was the, you know, remember, for a circuit, you have a hot, you go through a load, and you go back to a voltage source. Where was the voltage source in this situation? Physically. Where did that power line get its power from?
Back at the power plant
or a substation. Now at the substations that we have around here are transformers. Transformers have a center point on their Y that's connected to soil. So the path return was from that overhead power line through the soil willy-nilly, all paths proportional to resistance back to the ground rod where that transformer was earthed. That's where the current was going. So, here's a situation, two people tragically killed. Okay? So does that make sense? What happened here? Let's go to the next one. 11-year-old North Carolina girl electrocuted while in a swimming pool. Don't have any images of this because there weren't any. It's just the tell of what happened. What happened was out in the parking lot, out in front of the swimming pool complex, a power line blew down due to some reason. It fell and hit the ground in the asphalt parking lot out in front of the swimming pool. It's laying on the ground, and it's flopping around, electricity flowing. And what's happening, it's called an arcing fault, and there's not enough amplitude of current to actually trip the breaker or the relay back at the substation. So electricity is going to continue to flow until somebody gets there to open a sectionalizer switch or something. So what happened here is there were three girls in the pool when this thing occurred. Now, swimming pools are designed in such a way that they're just grounded to beat the band. All the rebar and the concrete's all bonded together. All of the conduits that come into the lights are all bonded together. The steel ladder that goes down into the water, it's anchored into the concrete, but underneath it's actually bonded to the steel. Just everything is as bonded together as it can be, so that if you happen to have a short circuit, there's a low impedance path back to the transformer to trip the breaker. But in this situation, it played against us. Because now your circuit is, you've got electricity here flowing through the soil, and between the substation and where this is, there's a swimming pool. So the swimming pool is full of chemicals. So the swimming pool is a better conductor than the soil on either side of the building. So a lot of the current is now flowing through the structure of the swimming pool, including the water of the pool. Two of the girls swam to the side of the pool and climbed out of the side of the pool. The third girl swam over to the aluminum ladder, and the instant she touched the ladder, she received a shock and fell back into the water unconscious. The lifeguard grabbed the aluminum hook, pole hook, and as he touched the water, he received a shock. And he pulled the pole away. Unfortunately, the girl did not get electrocuted. She drowned. She suffocated due to drowning. And it was all because of the current flowing through the water, basically paralyzed her body once she received that first shock at the ladder. So electricity flows in all paths available to it. And here was an example. Okay? And then this one is really humorous. Why do you think this is the case? Six times more?
Hey, it's just a flu cloud. Let's go up, crack open a six-pack, enjoy ourselves.
So you think it's our attitude, our indomitable, indestructible attitude.
We golf.
Those aren't
more.
The words I would use, but yes.
Yeah, what did you say?
We golf more than women.
We golf more, yes. Even God can hit a one iron. So, it's a fascinating thing. And American men. American men. Okay, this is my last example. Little girl playing in the rain goes to a commercial building, sidewalk with a puddle of water. She's splashing and tapping, and then just falls down unconscious and is electrocuted. And what happened is the rainwater filled up the floor box on the ground in the sidewalk. And you can see here's the wiring. They took a photograph of it, and they have wire nuts. Those of you who've handled wire nuts before, how waterproof are wire nuts?
Zero.
They're not waterproof at all. Whoever the installing person was of this, they used the wrong termination type. This thing filled up with water. We then got hot to ground connections, but we also got hot to steel connections. Hot to rebar, and electricity was flowing from here back into the building to where the panel board was and the transformer was that was feeding that circuit. Not enough amplitude to trip the breaker. So the breaker's just sitting there letting the current flow. Enough amplitude to exceed that 50 milliamps to kill this young lady. This was lawsuit city here. So anyway, just things that electrical safety that you've learned here about, electricity can be very deadly, but it can be very, very beneficial if we know how to handle it. So next week we're going to have, let's see what I have here. Yeah, this is this 12-year-old girl in this electric shock. I'll read this up as you read it, because I think that's the end of my presentation here. So next week we will have a quiz on electrical safety. It's 12 questions. You have been exposed to the answers to every one of the questions here today. Your handout has the answers to some of them. Okay? Probably 10 of the 12. Next week, we'll start with the quiz. Then we're going to self-grade the quiz. I'll have you just exchange, and then we're going to verbally go over the quiz. And then we'll do a little bit of a prep on just taking care of our lab equipment and the patch cords, and then we'll do lab one. So make sure you've got lab one. You're going to be energized next week. So any questions real quick? Mac, you can shut up. The drawers at each one of the six lab stations are full of patch cords. And I've asked Bree to kind of be responsible for getting this done. But what we want to do is we want to reallocate all of the number of cables in each drawer so that they're effectively about the same. They won't be exactly the same. Somehow, last year, I don't know how, but all of the dark blue cables, all of them, a lot of them just seemed to have disappeared. And we had several workstations that didn't have enough of the blue cables. So
we spent another $1,000 of the patch cords here in front of Bree, and each drawer probably has $1,000 of the patch cords in it. So we're going to reallocate. So there's going to be a lot of moving around. Please ignore them or get out of their way or something like that. Mac is going to help record the session today. Were there any questions about either the homework assignment or last week's lecture or anything before I start with what we're going to be doing today? So I was just super clear. Did you guys, what's going to then happen? I'm going to take all of your historic figure, and I'll combine these into a big long PDF file, and I'll repost it to you. And either next week or the week after, I'll then have a quiz on these historic characters. And my purpose is, previous semesters, we've actually had all of you give a 3 to 5 minute presentation on your particular person. There's not enough time with 24 students in the lab to do that effectively, and I don't want to keep losing time each month, each week. So what I'll do is we'll have a quick quiz, probably a 15, 20 minute quiz on these people. So once I send out on Blackboard or post on Blackboard the PDF of all of your work, then I'll create a quiz based on that material. That way you'll get a chance to read the material yourself, benefit from the work of your fellow students. And doing a quiz, also, I then know that you've read the material and absorbed it. And to me, this is very fascinating stuff, to look at how did we get to where we are today in the power industry. Because there's a lot of people that did a lot of work and took what previous people had done in previous generations and built on that. And when you read through this material, you'll see that. So, now today's lecture is on safety. And it's a very important lecture from the standpoint that, like I told you last week, this lab in particular will be the only lab that you probably do in your college career that can potentially kill you. And it's dangerous enough that I've got to get your attention, and I know we're doing a lot of activity here. Those of you who are volunteering, be listening to some of this, not all of it actually, as you're doing this. But there's things that we can do to be perfectly safe. We can handle electricity extremely safely. You as electrical engineers, when you guys graduate, you should be the gold standard of electrical safety in terms of how do you deal with it, how do you work with it. And what we're going to go over today are some of the foundations of how to work around electricity, how to respect it, how to make sure that you yourself don't get involved in an electrical circuit that can injure you and things such as this. In the electrician's world, the IBEW, the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, is an electrical union here in the United States. They have local chapters here in the Denver Front Range area. They actually give training on electrical safety. Now that training is focused specifically on in the field, doing construction, working with electricity, and it's more on working with the panel boards and things such as that and transformers. We're going to talk today specifically about how it applies to us with our lab equipment. Because our lab equipment is a little bit different environment. It's specifically made to be safe, to be safer, but it is still quite deadly. So we'll go into that. So any questions on this? Okay. We're not going to do the presentation of historic power maker files. We're going to go into electrical safety. We're going to talk about lightning safety. How many of you have ever had any kind of training at all on what in the world do you do if you're up above a tree line? You have? You have? Wow. So as we get there, if there's more that you have learned or been taught, share it with us.
Okay. So, first thing is Career Day is going to be showing up here in the next few weeks. And something that I see all the time with mine students is that there's always a floating question mark over a lot of your heads about what is the best way to dress when I'm going to meet somebody that I'd like to work with their company. And my very first semester here, I was driving on campus to park, and it was raining, lightly raining. And I encountered a young man crossing the street, so I paused, let him cross the street. And he was in a black pants, black suit, white shirt, black tie, and it looked like his hair had not been combed for several weeks, and it was wet. And he was wet. And I was going, the only reason that either he's going to a funeral or he's going to a job interview. And I could tell that if he's coming to meet me, I'm not going to be impressed at all. And he looked so uncomfortable, and I just went, he really needed somebody to pull him aside and just say, hey, there's a lot easier way to dress that you'll be comfortable, the person you're meeting will be comfortable, and you'll have accomplished what you want, is introduce yourself to somebody and present your resume to them or present your credentials to them in some way. So when you go to, how many of you have been to Career Days already in the past? Okay, how many have not? Okay, those of you who have not, when you go there, in terms of answering the question mark over your head, just look at how the people are dressed that are up there behind the desks that you want to meet. You're going to see that very, very few of them are in a suit and tie. A lot of them will be in a polo shirt, or like I am, a dress shirt, dress slacks, and an open collar. Sometimes it might be a tie, but very rarely are we dressed to the nines like we're going to the Oscars or something like that. So look at the people on the other side, and how are they dressed? And then when you finally go there to meet them, just emulate that, okay? Especially when you go into a job interview, if you're overdressed, you're going to feel more uncomfortable, which affects your relating to the people that you're trying to interview with, okay? We talked about this last week. In this lab, we're going to talk about proper attire. And if you show up for a lab, and we've got energized or rotating equipment, and you've got sandals on, you're not going to be able to participate. And so just make sure you keep a pair of tennis shoes in your backpack or someplace close by that you can get to. So that's just one thing I want to make sure that everybody keeps track of. Clicker is not working. Sometimes it is working. Okay. The material you're about to go through, will be on a quiz next week. And every once in a while, I'm going to give you a really, really strong hint about something that'll be on the quiz. And what's in front of you right now, I predict will be on the quiz, okay? Every one of you in this room is responsible for the safety of everybody else in this room when it comes to energized equipment around here. When you're working at these lab stations, there's going to be you and three other students. I'm not going to be there hovering over you, watching you, making sure that you're being safe. Now what we're going to do is we're going to talk about this. We're going to assign a safety officer for each lab. So of the four of you, one of you will be what we'll identify as the safety officer. That individual is just simply going to stand back and observe the other three, hooking things up and running things and making measurements. When in the lab book, it'll say, have your wiring inspected. Well, that's me. What's going to happen? I'm going to walk over and I'm going to address the safety officer. I'm going to say, safety officer, show me the wiring. Then the safety officer, the other three, step back and the safety officer will present the wiring connections to me. But that way, you're always going to have somebody helping make sure that you don't put your finger someplace you shouldn't
that you're not putting your hands across something that's energized and things such as that, okay? So, everyone is responsible for everybody else's safety. So, here are going to be two statements. So, the first statement here, is this true or false?
True.
It's true. Is it entirely true?
As close as it ever has.
So, which statement is more true? Okay. And as an electrical engineer, and you guys as electrical engineers, if you walk out of this lab with anything, this bottom statement, I have succeeded in one of the things I want to do in this lab. Now think about how misleading that first statement is. It's true, but it's misleading. It's dangerously misleading, isn't it? Okay? You're going to hear professors make this statement. When they make the statement, you should raise your hand and say, "Professor, doesn't electricity flow everywhere where it has a path of resistance available to it?" And they'll go, "Well, yeah, you're right. But electricity, when it's flowing anywhere, it's not flowing in only the path of least resistance. Yes, it's flowing there, but it's flowing every other path available to it. If we had some circumstance occur in here where we energized the steel of that ceiling grid right there, and the branch circuit that's feeding it is over here in a panel board, and the neutral in that panel board is connected to the ground inside the transformer, we're going to talk about this as we keep going. There is a circuit path from the hot wire and the breaker through the pipe to the steel in that ceiling grid, and then every path of steel in this entire building will now carry current back to where the ground is connected into the transformer. Every path to the whole building. Now there will be a few paths that are of much lower resistance that will carry more current, but every place else will carry current. And how we design electrical systems in buildings is we design them in a way so that when you walk into a building, if there is something mistakenly energized that shouldn't be energized, you should be safe. And you expect to walk into a building and be safe that you can touch any metallic piece of that building and not be electrocuted, right? So that's how we design it. What we do is we put in what we call a bonding system inside a building, so that every electrical component that could possibly become energized is in some way bonded to the steel of the building or bonded to cold water pipes in the building, and that bond eventually goes back to that to the transformers that are surrounding the building. Now, there's a lone small 3/4 inch conduit that's going up into the ceiling over there. What's inside that pipe is a green, individual green conductor. And it's a ground conductor, and it connects to the what we call the XO lug inside that transformer, and it goes up above the ceiling. I haven't looked, but more than likely, it just goes up to a beam, a steel beam above the ceiling, and then there's a grounding clamp, or it's been welded to that steel. So now we have an electrical connection from the door frames, from the other conduit, from floor, the walls, the outlets, everything that could become energized has a what we call a low impedance path back to that XO lug. And that's how we designed worldwide electrical systems are done that way in general. And it's all because electricity is going to flow everywhere that it has available to it. So just take that first sentence, that first line, and just know that it's true, but it is incredibly misleading. It's incredibly false. It's short-sighted in terms of making that statement. Okay? Now, electrical shock to the human body affects us in different ways, and we can get the electrical shocks in different ways. And we get primary injuries. How many of you have ever been shocked? Okay, so a lot of you have. When you did get shocked
after it happened, did you step back and go, oh, well, gee, I know why I got shocked. I did X and Y, and I'm never going to do that again, right? Was it painful? Okay, painful here, kind of painful. It certainly got your attention, okay? In electrical shock, the electrical systems that we have in buildings, there's enough energy there that if you get across it, there's going to be enough current flowing to damage your tissue, to cause your muscles to react in a different way that you're not expecting, and potentially, if it's coming in some way across your chest cavity, across your heart, it could actually stop your heart. And you will not, by yourself, be able to restart your heart. You're either going to die, or someone's going to help you restart your heart. Okay? We're going to talk about that a little bit more in this lab. Now, the other thing that can happen is, when you have an electrical charge flowing through your body, your brain and your brain stem controls your neurological system. And there are electrochemical impulses that go from your brain out to your muscles. And we control how we move with our brain. But it's electrical impulses that ultimately cause your muscles to contract and to move. Now, who did Galvani? Okay, Mac, what happened when Galvani touched the frog legs with dissimilar metal instruments?
Yeah, he essentially completed a circuit with different metals and the frog leg in between, and it caused it to twitch.
Okay, so you're going to read about this, but it was just one of these aha moments in history. Galvani was doing research, biological research, on dead frog legs and laying in his bench. He would pin them to the bench to measure them or do something of, but when he would touch them with instruments, these dead frog legs would jerk, would move, they would contract. And he would step back and go, you know, this is supposed to be a dead animal and it's moving on me. So anyway, electrical impulses will cause our muscles to move. Now in the electrical world, we have many stories of electricians talking about getting across electrical systems and their fist completely clamping closed. Clamping closed to the point that you're not going to be able to pull your hand off. A friend comes over, magically tries to grab your hand and pull it off. They can't pull your hand off. Just with all the strength of the bone and the tissue and the muscle, you are clamped on and you cannot let go. Other things that can happen. They talk about people getting electrocuted and it says it threw them across the room. Well, sometimes it can be a blast, an explosion, and the explosive nature of expanding gases can blow someone across the room, but often what happens is a person is knelt down next to a receptacle. You're in a squatted position like a baseball catcher or something like that. You get across the electricity, and what happens is your legs actually spring and actually you jump backwards. Your body, your muscles throw you backwards. It's not the electricity doing it, it's your muscles. Okay? So, muscular contractions take place. Now, you can also have enough heat to burn your skin. Okay, and burns go all the way to deep third degree burns. And we have enough energy in these power supplies that we can burn you pretty good. And if you're then clamped on and the breaker doesn't trip, we're going to do some tissue damage with this lab equipment. So, something to be make sure you have. Now, the function of the heart. Now, as low as 50 milliamperes, gee, that seems like a number you ought to remember. As little as 50 milliamperes across your chest cavity can change your heart. Now, your heart is a muscle. It is responding to electrical impulses from your brain stem, but it also has an internal clock that's inherent in the muscle itself to keep it beating. And if that gets interrupted, it has a very difficult time retuning itself. So the heart
might still be trying to pump, but normally there's a suck and a push, a suck and a push, how our hearts work. If that timing isn't working, and they're both sucking and pushing at the same time, or they're both just pulsing and what we call fibrillation, the heart will no longer push oxygenated blood to the brain. How much time do we have from the point in time when your heart stops effectively pushing the oxygen to the brain to when you're dead?
5 minutes.
Your 5 minutes?
Closer to 3.
3 to 5 minutes. The range is actually based on how much oxygen you had in your brain before, but anywhere from 3 to 7 minutes. So we're going to talk about what are we going to do with our precious 3 to 7 minutes if one of us goes down. We're going to talk about that as we get further into this lecture. Now, the extent of the shock injury depends on the amount of current, the voltage, the resistance, how long the current is applied. Why don't you guys keep spreading out, go to the back two tables also, because you'll start impeding here. The duration of the shock, you can have a low level of current flowing through you, but if you can't pull yourself away from it, the longer the current flows, the more dangerous it can be. Okay? Now the pathway is also incredibly important. Those of you who had a shock, if you got shocked, say, across a capacitor on your hand, the circuit was just through the skin of your hand. The rest of your body probably wasn't involved in the circuit. I heard that you've got, you know, neural sensing in your hand, something like that. But the more dangerous places is anything that's going to flow through the chest cavity. So electricians in the field are taught about hand-to-hand over your head. If you grab hold of something energized here and you're grounded here, the current flow is down your arms, it's across your chest cavity. Any kind of hand-to-foot, it's down the arm, across the chest cavity, down through the legs. Again, anything that's going to pass current across your chest cavity are things that you've got to be very, very, very careful about. Now, we talk about touch potential. Now, touch potential is when you're touching something, and then if there's a possibility of a current path, then your potential in that situation is referring to voltage. So touch voltage, touch potential, very similar terms. The other one is step potential, and this is foot to foot. And as we go further into the lecture today, we're going to know more and talk more about what's happening in foot to foot. People who are killed often by lightning, who are not actually struck by lightning, it's often the step potential that has killed them. And that's because when there's lightning striking in the vicinity, there's electricity that's flowing through the surface of the earth. And if you imagine yourself and your friends, your associates, other people, imagine yourself as you are nothing more than a bag of salty water. That you are a much better conductor than the dirt between your legs. So the electricity that's flowing through the soil will come up one leg through your torso, down the other leg, because you're a better conductor than the dirt. Even if the dirt is wet, you're a better conductor. Okay? Same thing's going to happen in here in this lab. If you imagine yourself as a bag of salty water, you're a better conductor than the surface of this table. You're a better conductor than the surface of that lab bench. So just keep in mind that you are such a good conductor, you need to make sure you're protecting yourself and insulating yourself. Now, another table that I think is really important. How many of you brought your handout that I published yesterday? Okay. This table is in that handout. In fact, a lot of this material is in that handout. Now, from 1 milliamp to 8 milliamps, basically, you're going to feel it. It might or might not be painful, but you're aware of it enough that you're going to draw your hand away. Okay?
but you're not really going to be hurt. Up to 15 milliamps, it's going to hurt. But you're not going to lose your muscular control. You can again pull your hand away from it. Okay, then you get up to the 20 milliamp level. Now it's painful. You're going to start losing control of those muscles. Those muscles are going to tense up. There was a story about an electrician who was found electrocuted, and he was doing some measurements underneath a piece of switchgear that had a pit underneath it. And he was measuring conductor size or something. The switchgear above him was energized. And he had the front panels off. And when they found him with his hard hat melted to his head. And they found him completely drawn up and tucked into the bottom of the switchboard. And it took a while for them to realize what happened. And what he had done is he had his hard hat on. He had some PPE gear on, but he had bare hands. And he was measuring something down underneath, and as he was measuring, he had one hand or the other down inside the pit, but the other hand was over here, and somehow one arm or the other got hold of electricity. And what happened is, as soon as he was energized, his muscles contracted and it actually pulled him forward, his arms pulled him forward, forced his head and skin into a live bus, and it instantly killed him. And breakers might have tripped and things like that, but he was dead before the breakers tripped. And it's just an example where you come back in forensically and look at the situation. Why in the world was this man so crawled into the space? And he wasn't. It was an involuntary reaction of his muscles. Okay, that starts happening at the 20 milliamps. Up to 50 to 100 milliamps, the ventricular fibrillation starts. And it's an uncontrolled twitching of the muscle. So the effective movement of blood through the vessels has now stopped when this happens. If this isn't fixed, within 3 to 7 minutes, the individual will die. Okay? Fatal shock occurs from 100 milliamps up to 200 milliamps. We're talking milliamps. We're not talking amps, milliamps. Okay? This gear has 50 amp circuit breakers on it, our power supplies. So we have the potential to way exceed 200 milliamps. That's 0.2 amps. The motors and the little motors we have in here, they drive full load amps, are 1.7 amps. We have equipment in here that's way exceeding these thresholds of being dangerous to you. Okay, over 200 milliamps, severe burns, severe muscular contractions, so severe the muscles of the chest, well actually your diaphragm and your chest cavity will press down and actually compress the heart and stop it actually being able to freely move and pump. Okay, you can actually have your muscles suffocate yourself. Okay, so it's an important table, especially for next week. Now, when we have an uncontrolled amount of electricity flowing, whenever electricity flows through the air, we will call it an arc. So lightning is a type of arc. How many of you, when you've plugged something in or unplugged something, you've seen there's a little pop, a little spark? That's an arc. It's a very, very small arc. But in big electrical systems, arcs can travel inches and feet in the air. When they're doing that, they're extremely hot. When they're extremely hot, they are superheating the air. If you're around something that startles you and you're surprised, what's one of the first things that you do in terms of reacting? What you'll do is you go, huh? You inhale.
Now that's part of our fight and flight reflex of getting oxygen into our system so that we can take off and start running. But what happens if you inhale and there's superheated air around you? You suck that air into your lungs. A lot of people who are severely injured from electrical strikes, especially lightning that have hit them, is they have second and third degree burns in the lining of their lungs from inhaling involuntarily the superheated air around them. Now, we probably don't have enough energy in our power supplies in the lab for something like that to happen. But when you get out in the world and start looking and interfacing with higher power electrical systems, just know that much energy is there and inherently in this gear. In fact, we have that much energy in these panel boards over here. Now, the air basically during an arc becomes a conductive medium, and you actually get a plasma, what we would call a plasma, flowing through the air. It's very noisy, very hot, 35,000 degrees potentially. And in this lab, we basically, you know, don't have that much energy, but just tell yourself that you're never going to pull an energized patch cord out of the power supply or out of our equipment unless the power supply is de-energized. We'll talk about that a little bit more. Now, a blast. Whenever you have an arc happening, you've got expansive air that is superheated, that is expanding out. And it's very similar that it will also cause metals to melt in the vicinity of the arc. And when copper melts, take this number, 67,000 times its original volume, and that's actually equivalent to dynamite. So if you get an arc going on, you've got the equivalent of a rod of copper in front of you that can just explode at this level of expansion. So there's a lot of electricians that are severely injured, not only from the heat of the arc and the infrared burning their face, burning their skin, catching their clothing on fire, but the hot molten metal that's vaporized in the air showering on them and hitting them at these temperatures. There's a lot of electricians who have survived arc blast events, get home and find these micro holes in their clothing as this hot metal hit their clothing and just melted right through it. And it dissipated its energy before it got to their skin. But it's a real phenomenon that you need to make sure that you're aware of. Now, personal protection, you can take action yourself to make sure that you are safe. I've been doing this lab now for 6 or 7 years, and prior to this lab is, you know, probably more than 10 years, and fortunately we've been blessed, we've never had an injury. I predict, and my anticipation is, we'll go through this entire lab here today, this semester, without any of you being hurt. I had a student a couple of semesters ago, I heard it, and he felt it, that he got across some voltage, and he stepped back, and I walked over, you know, are you okay, and all this, and he was very embarrassed, because he realized that he had made one of the fundamental mistakes, that trying to rewire without being de-energized. Got his attention, but he wasn't injured. He was hurt, but not injured. He's probably a little bit more than that. Now, I'm going to walk over here and show you just some things about energized equipment. Whenever you're in a situation where you're around equipment that you're not necessarily familiar with, one of the best things to do is learn the habit of what we call in the electrical industry the right-hand rule, or the one-hand rule. And if you're right-handed, you should always plan that you're going to put your left hand behind you so that You're only touching things with one hand at a time. Now, what immediately will that give you as a benefit? Exactly right. What you're doing is you're taking your chest cavity away from the current path. If you're on good tennis shoes, like I want you to have on, you've actually got a lot of insulation through those shoes, and it's possible you could touch something that's hot, that's energized, and you're not making a circuit. That's why pigeons can sit on a power line with both feet and not get electrocuted, because they're not in the circuit. Okay? So that's why you see that that can happen. So, if you're walking up to a piece of equipment, just like we have here, you shouldn't just put both hands on the equipment, because you're putting your chest cavity in a possible circuit. What will often happen is we will tell you that you should, I don't know if you can make sure you see it, you should just lightly brush it with the back of your hand. Where you want to touch it is right at the top of the cuticles of your fingernails. Now those, that place right there, if you poke yourself with a pin right there, you'll feel it, right? You've got a lot of nerve endings right there. I don't know why we made that way, but a lot of nerve endings. Now, if it's energized, though, why is it important to brush it with the back of your hand?
Is that way, if your hand contracts, you're not going to grab it.
Your hand will not grab it, but also your hand will naturally...